Joining us now on Hot Coffee, we have Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel. Senator Pimentel, good morning to you, sir.
Magandang umaga, Karen, and to all of our viewers and listeners. Good morning. All right.
Umiinit na po ang usaping ito. Number one, it has a majority of the support in the lower house. And the latest is the Senate Committee on Constitutional Amendments and Revision of Codes, led by Senator Robin Padilla, said that it's almost done with a report on the resolution seeking to amend the restrictive economic provisions of the Constitution. What happens next? Take us first, Senator Pimentel. Once that report is finished, what happens in the Senate?
It depends on the recommendation of the committee, because there are three recognized ways to amend the Constitution, amend or revise. Pag sinabi mong amend, piecemeal, pag revise, overhaul. Ngayon, if it is the third one, wag na natin pag-usapan because that's people's initiative, no? So very specific yan. And then dalawa na lang pong pwedeng ma-recommend po ng ating committee, which would be to convert the present Congress, that two houses, as a constituent assembly. And then another one is to the purpose of converting into a constituent assembly is to propose amendments to the Constitution. And then the second possible report would be for the committee will recommend the calling of the election for members of the Constitutional Convention. So yun, whether or which of the two the committee will recommend, I have no idea as of the moment.
Now, Senator Pimentel, are you even open at all to changing the Constitution today?
Changing, yes, but not now. Because we have our people are really facing very challenging times. Mahirap po ang buhay ngayon, actually. Mm-hmm. And then, so we have domestic problems. And if you look at the world, the world has gotten so complicated, not only in trading or economic matters, but also in the politics of the world. Itong tinatawag na geopolitical issues. So ang dami pong problema. This will really eat up our time. This will refocus our attention. Yun. And then our energies. There are only 24 hours in a day, Karen. That's a rule. We cannot multiply time, ladies and gentlemen.
So for you, Senator Pimentel, the issue is the timing. But when would the time be right?
Because my party, you know, the original PDP Laban, is for federalism, which is really a system of government. So it's naturally political. It's a political topic. So we have taken the long-term view na kailangan pahinugin muna ito sa issue. Our people are not yet well informed about what federalism is, what are the different forms, and what are the possible benefits. So we are willing to be patient, but we are not against charter change, because in order to accomplish our basic objective of the adoption of a federal system of government, we really have to change the Constitution. That is the PDP Laban's position since its formation in the 1980s, early 1980s.
Now, Senator Pimentel, you've always stood for federalism. Even former President Duterte believed in federalism. But the discussions right now in the Senate, at least with most of your colleagues, is if it does push through, that's not even the issue anymore. It's not right. Federalism. It's right. Only about changing the economic provisions in the 1987 Constitution. Would you first be open to just changing the economic provisions?
For the issue of federalism, which we are espousing, we say that not yet now, mm-mm, because it will have its proper time. So for some other matter, which is not about federalism, which is not on our radar, which is not one of the reasons why we agree to amending the 1987 Constitution. So therefore, we are not all the more in favor of opening up that route, that issue, amend the Constitution as far as economic provisions are concerned. It's the same thing. It will now eat up our time. It will now refocus our attention on more important matters.
But then you spoke earlier about poverty. You talked about the problems the Philippines is facing economically. And some argue that changing the economic provisions would help solve that. So I wanted to ask you, the Philippine Constitution, they say, is the most restrictive in Asia. It is the third most restrictive in the world. So pag-usapan po natin yun. Hindi ba makakatulong, for example, even if there's been an amendment on the Public Services Act, it will be made clear to foreign investors that utilities are included right now in public services because there is a case pending in the Supreme Court. Don't you want clarity on some issues on where foreign investors can come in?
You know, foreign investors, when they invest in a country, that means that they are willing to play by the rules of that country. So they can look at the Constitution and they can look at the laws. So ganun naman yun eh. So they see now that in our Constitution, we have reserved the ownership of educational institutions, media outlets, the exploitation of our natural resources, and then public utilities. But we have by law opened up public services. So they have to learn to play by our rules. Mm-hmm. And definitely, we can see a lot of foreign investments in our country. Diba? They have invested under the 1987 Constitution. Some have even invested maybe under the 1973 Constitution. Some under the 1935 Constitution. So ganun lang po yun kasi they have to play by our rules. Let the foreign investors should adjust to the rules established by Filipinos, not us adjusting to them. At any rate, my conclusion is that the poverty that we see all around us here in the Philippines was not caused by the Constitution. This has been caused by unfair policies.
And what are these unfair policies? Because I wanted to bring up, you said that foreigners should adjust to our constitution, but we live in a very competitive global economy. Mm-hmm. We're seeing right now Vietnam, for example, given that Vietnam is even politically speaking, more closed politically, right? Yes. But Vietnam is actually cornering billions of dollars in foreign direct investments. I mean, during the pandemic, they were still hitting $20 billion a year. Now it's hitting, close to $100 billion a year. The point being is the Philippines, maybe we've had a high of 5 or a high of 6. Why would foreign direct investors go to us when, constitutionally, even after the amendment, it's not clear to them exactly what they can engage in and invest on?
I think it's clear. It's clear that what they can invest in it, because nothing can be clearer than the Constitution. You know, the laws can change. The Constitution has more or less permanent condition. So when they read the Constitution, they know the OPSA, this will be good for 10 to 20 years. Unlike a law can be changed after 2 months, yes, or after half a year. So what is important is, number one, our power, energy costs. Number two, our justice system. Importante po yun eh. Because wala na sa Constitution yung, there is a dispute in the interpretation of a contract. What is in the Constitution is how to resolve that dispute. We have a judicial system, so our judicial system must be efficient and should be trustworthy. And then, so yung mga ganon, Karen, so because, for example, you use Vietnam as the example. That's a communist system. So mga Western investors.
But that's the irony. It's a communist political system, but yet in terms of business and the economy, they're so attractive to foreign direct investments because they're less restrictive.
Correct.
To the economic provisions.
Yes, less restrictive because they have a more or less autocratic system. It's a dictatorship of the political party. So therefore, ang ibig sabihin nun, isa lang ang kausap nila. Okay, sa Pilipinas, marami tayong checks and balances, demokrasya. So do we want to live like the Vietnam system or the Philippine system? You know, progress is still possible under the Philippine system, except that we have to be more fair. We have to be more fair. Our elections must really reflect the will of the people so that they send representatives to the policy-making bodies, their own representatives.
Uh-oh. And then Senator Pimentel, I mean, I don't mean to interrupt, but here's one. As a mother, and we want our children to be global citizens, right? We want Filipinos to be global citizens. Our education, for example, you're seeing other countries. They have a Harvard in the Middle East, or they have an Ivy League school in other parts of the world. It's completely foreign owned. I don't understand myself why a school has only here. Why does it have to be Filipino owned? Don't you find that old? The world isn't like that anymore.
Yes, and even in the media entities. Yeah.
Yeah. So that, what about those two? Isn't that old?
Yes. Old way of thinking. That's why we have to keep on debating this. But ang tanong is, do we open up the Constitution for those two reasons and right now? And then will that solve the unemployment problem? How many employees will those potential investors employ? I mean, it's not worth it, you know, to open the Constitution right now, that economic provisions. And then this is one thing which should be pointed out, Karen. Although they call it economic provisions, there is one rider. Tawag ko dyan rider kasi it's not necessarily connected with economic provisions. It's the land ownership. They also want to open land ownership. And they use Vietnam as the example of an economic success. But Vietnam does not even allow foreign ownership of land. So imagine. So why is it there? I mean, bakit nasisingit it yung land ownership na yan, which can add to the controversy and to the resistance and opposition. Ngayon pa lang nga, meron nang resistance against opening up or relaxing the so-called economic provisions. And then you introduce a rider there about land ownership. So I think this will now result in more opposition to the call for charter change right now. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. When it comes to land ownership, you are correct. In fact, many other Western countries who once were open to foreign land residential ownership are reneging and have actually are calling to stop that because it's making the price of real estate more expensive for the locals. But what about long-term lease for foreigners who want to start up a company, for example? I know there are Asian countries, I believe, with more than 50 years, some with 99 years. What about that?
Yes. I don't think the Constitution prohibits the leasing of land in the Philippines by foreigners because it's really land ownership, Karen. So that can be done by law if that's the concern. And I think there is already an existing law, 50 years, and then renewable for another 50 years, if I am not mistaken, but that's what I remember.
Okay. So, Senator, being minority floor leader, so you're clear that you are open to charter change, but you oppose the timing, not today. Number two, in fact, yours is an all the way change. It's to the system of government.
Right.
Because your goal was always really federalism.
Correct.
My question is, with the lobby right now for charter change, they're talking about the manner, constitutional convention or constituent assembly. In case this is really pushed in the Senate and you'd have to take a vote, would you vote completely no to charter change, or you'd at least consider one or the other? Because right now it's even, we're talking about even possibly the future of the Senate itself. If constitutional convention wins, that's a whole different model, right? Wherein no less than former Senate President Juan Ponce Enrile said it's too expensive. Yeah. It can already change through constituent assembly. Okay. Ano pong pananaw niyo, sir?
Okay, I will just play along with your assumptions.
But, yes, yes.
Anyway.
Yung halimbawa.
Yes, as a mathematician, I can do that. Ganyan ang mga word problems. Assume. We will assume. We will assume, yes. If that were now the situation, I would go with the constituent assembly as the mode to change the constitution, whether amend or revise. But the point is, as I've told our chairman, Senator Robin Padilla, this is a formal process, Karen, no? That we should not confuse when we are in session that we are in session as a legislative body or we are in session as a constituent assembly. So we have to make some formalities, a formal break, because we cannot amend the constitution through law as sitting as a legislative body. So there must be some formal processes we will observe that at this point we will now declare ourselves as a constituent assembly, then now we convert the topics, which would be the constitution. And then we may need to form different committees, Karen, for the different articles in the constitution.
Why do you prefer a constituent assembly over a constitutional convention, considering you have Congressman Rufus Rodriguez saying that a constituent assembly may be unpopular with the people, iisipin daw ng tao sila na naman, a constitutional convention, they say, represents the people.
Represents the CONCON delegates, possibly may represent the people if we put some disqualifications there for relatives of incumbent politicians from running. Pwede, posible. But if we choose the constitutional convention mode, look at the expense, the election expense, the campaign, the election, and then the time that will be necessary for them to organize. Yung sinabi ko kanina na yung gagawin pa nga ng Senate and the House, may break pa yan. We have to form the committees. Ganun din sila. They will have to look for their office, their convention center, hire their people after having been elected. So siguro 1 year and a half, we will lose 1 year and a half. So if we want to be practical about it, we can go for the constituent assembly mode. At any rate, this the two houses of Congress will be voting separately. Mm-hmm. So the Senate can check the House proceedings and the House results, and then the House can also check the Senate proceedings as well as the Senate proposals.
Why do you think are your colleagues in the lower house pushing for charter change now? What motive are you seeing?
That I do not know. The media should interview the members of the House. Pero my colleagues in the Senate say that they see this as a pattern. No? Every new administration, this is a ritual for every new administration. That's what I've heard from my colleagues who have come from the House of Representatives.
And that's true, because even Senator Robin Padilla said, hindi pwede sabihin ng mga kasamahan ko sa Senado na hindi sila for charter change, kasi mismo nga sila nag-file noon for charter change. So ang tanong, Senator, why it's never succeeded, even at least in the lower house, with the numbers it has today. Today, it's overwhelming with, I think, 301 who voted for it, right? As a in the manner of changing it via CONCON. So I think historically, even if other administrations have tried, it's never reached this far in the lower house. Am I correct with my memory?
Yeah, yeah, I think so. This far and this early.
This far and this early. Yeah. So you've advocated for this before. What's the problem before? Is it a lack of trust? Because it seems the timing's always an issue. But is it really a trust issue?
Well, also the composition of Congress has changed. So tignan din natin yun. So before, during my time as Senate President, I felt that the overwhelming composition of the Senate was against charter change. Any form, economic man or political, ang pag-usapan, I think they were against. In this particular Senate, we have the chairman himself of the Constitutional Amendments Committee who is in favor of amending or revising the Constitution. So that's a big difference. And siguro sa House, nagbago rin ang composition. That's why we already have 300 plus voting for CONCON. Unfortunately, it's not clear in their version if they want to disqualify from membership in the CONCON their own relatives.
It's clear. There is no ban. Their own relatives can run.
So, yun. Pero hindi pa naman final yun. So, should. Let's assume. Ito, back to some math problems tayo, Karen. No, let's assume na yun po ang mananaig na procedure on amending the Constitution or revising the Constitution. We have to make sure. We have to put that close relatives, we just define what are close relatives. Close relatives of the legislators, lahat kami.
Until the fourth.
Should be disqualified from running as a constitutional convention delegate. Dapat yan.
But then let's be honest. Do you think honestly that this hybrid CONCON coming from the lower house as the numbers in the Senate, because Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri,
wala.
That's the big problem.
It doesn't have
the numbers. Yeah.
Wala. They have made it also more complicated because CONCON, for me, supposed to be representatives of the people who the people determine through elections. If you make it so-called hybrid, you again complicate the topic.
Because there are appointed.
Are appointed. So the appointed can represent vested interests. So that's a problem. So yeah. So if they want really CONCON, yeah, they have to simplify the rules. It should be a purely elected CONCON, and then we have to disqualify our close relatives from running and being members or delegates to the CONCON. Mm-hmm. But of course, I will repeat. No, if forced to choose right now between calling for a CONCON and a constituent assembly, if we are serious in amending, changing the constitution, the most practical manner would be constituent assembly.
Because yan ang tanong ko sa inyo, sir, if it's forced, kumbaga it suddenly has the numbers, constituent assembly, you will choose to participate, right? In which provisions you only want changed?
Yes, if we will convert into a constituent assembly, that all of a sudden that becomes part of my duty as a senator. Kasi alam ko naman nung ako'y tumakbo pagka senador at nung nahalala ko bilang senador, alam ko na I wear one main hat, which is a legislator, but there's a potential second hat, which is as a member of a constituent assembly to propose amendments to the constitution.
All right. But it's clear we have to let our viewers know that you are against really charter change today.
Today,
because the timing for you is wrong.
Yes, because number one, ang dami nating problema na pwede naman natin sagutin or i-address through laws. And then number two, yung subject matter ng aking advokasya sa charter change ay federalism. Kailangan pang pahinugin sa taong bayan, kailangan pang ipaliwanag. Siguro, that's why we are patient about it.